Hello and welcome to another premiere draft of Kalades Remastered. And rare is not good. I'm not going to pick that one. It's very unreliable. Sometimes you have good cards in your hand, you never know what you are going to draw. So this would be only good in a very late game situation where you were able to hold some useless cards like lands or some weak 2-drops in your hand. But generally not a very good card. I like the Dragster, I like the Pacification Array, and out of the commons, the Chaser is the best card. I think I'm gonna choose one of these artifacts. I mean, this Glimmer of Genius isn't bad either, but I'd rather take a card that is colorless, and I'd rather take this. This is not quite Icy Manipulator, but it's still a good tapper, I think, so I'll pick that. It will go make the deck anyway. And well, there is a Tesseract's Touch. I had one draft where I had like three of these. It was quite fun. It's a nice card, but then again, we do have here a single color useful card, Daring Demolition. Also, Revoke Privileges. The best green card is Thriving Rhino, and I guess you could kind of go this route too. I already have an artifact for this thing, so you could kind of get like an artifact-based blue something deck, and guess you can say, but when you can play these things like for 3 and 4 mana, they're gonna be very excellent. So this actually could be a reasonable pick too. Should I maybe try that kind of a stuff? It's very risky, of course, because if it doesn't work, because this is always a good card. Okay, fine, I think I'll do it like now. In one of my earlier drafts, I got some discussion with a my viewer in the comment section, and they really were preferring this Gearseeker Serpent, and I think their arguments were quite reasonable. So this really could be, I mean, normally you can get these very late, but I want to try this kind of pick now. I think in a regular case I just would take the Daring Demolition, but I have played a lot of these drafts and I have picked countless of Daring Demolitions and Chandra's Revolution, so I want to try something different, and I think this is a valid way to start the draft, definitely. So here, there is something like, I think I might just take the Prophetic Prism in here, just to kind of try to go deep with this kind of plan. I usually don't force any kind of an archetype, but I think that it is a fine card anyway, and let's see how it goes. So there is a malfunction here. I might just not take the removal that goes to my colors. I saw a Weldfast Engineer. I didn't, of course, pick it. It doesn't really go well with this double blue card here, so I'm not gonna take these. I think I'll just take the malfunction here. Maybe I'll table something like Sky Skiff or Dukkara Peafowl if I'm lucky. I would definitely consider playing either of those. And here it's gonna be the Aether Swooper. This is an excellent thing. Excellent 2-drop. I think this is the best of the options. I mean, the three good 2-drops, black, red and blue, have these same kind of cards as 2-drops, and this blue is the best. Each of them is very good, and this blue one is the best. It's gonna be better than this. I could go kind of like self-assembler route, but I won't, because we have such a nice quality 2-drop in here. So now we have a Chandra's Revolution coming very late, and I'm not gonna pick like an Eco Construct because it's an artifact, or Hinterland Drake because it goes for my colors. I just take the best card from the pack now, and of course I do want to have access to removal as well. This is also quite splashable, and I also had a Prism in here, so I easily can just not play more red than a couple of removal spells. I think here the best card is just going to be the Poisoner in here. This is mostly a sideboard card, and this is a best of one draft, so there's not going to be any sideboard, so I'm not going to even consider picking this. I wouldn't play this in my main deck. Yeah, I take the Poisoner, and I'll see if the blue is going to be most likely one of our colors, and then let's see if it's going to be red or black, or I guess it could be even white or green as well, the missing color. Ice Over, I already have a malfunction, so I don't think I want to have too many of these kind of effects. We have a reasonable pick in the Peafowl. I mean, so far I don't have any artifact synergies other than the Serpent, but I hope to pick a couple of more of these, and if I end up playing black, I can take the Improvise black things, although those are quite splashable too. The 7 mana 5/5 cannot be blocked by artifact creatures with Improvise. I could even splash those. I don't have to be like a black main color for those cards. So I'm gonna look to pick like more Gesika Serpents and then any kind of improvised cards that would go to my colors. So the pack's coming now. Okay, so here, I don't think I want to pick another Peafowl. I could take the Ambition. I mean, card draw is nice, but I might also be able to pick up those blue. What's the artifact that draws two cards? I mean, if I pick a couple of those, I wouldn't have to play the Tesseract Ambition. I think I'm gonna take the Pillar Bug here because if I'm playing black, it will be very nice playable. And here it's gonna be the Implement of Malice. Of course, that means I need to play black like a. Not just splash lightly. I need to play a lot of black in order to play this card, but I just don't think the Eyes Over is a card I want to pick very, very kind of eagerly. Here we are, take another Pillar Bug, and I think I might prefer going black, blue, and maybe splash the Chandra's Revolution. Hopefully, pick like a one or two more red single caster removals. I take this, but it's very unlikely to go to the deck. This is a nice playable, so not so sure how that's so late in the pack. This won't be making the cut no matter what. Okay, Electrostatic Pummeler. Yeah, no, this is not an energy deck, so this won't do anything. I also don't have any way to boost my creature's power, so no thanks. But there is a Welding Sparks though, so I'm gonna pick it. I guess there is also the Daring Demolition, but in this deck this might just be a better one. I mean, it's a cheaper, it can deal us enough damage here so that it's basically destroy target anything. It doesn't destroy a vehicle until it's accrued, but because it's an instant speed spell, I don't think it's a problem. There's also the Whirler Virtuoso, which is a very good card, but I maybe prefer to just splash red. Regardless, I'll take the Welding Sparks here, and I will at least splash red here, and hopefully maybe pick another Prism in here. Okay, so Hidden Stockpile, nice card. I don't think I have gotten. I don't think I have played this even once in all of my drafts, and I have like a, oh, I think. Over 40 drafts combined, and I haven't put this to my deck yet. So for some reason, I've never been black white when I've been past these things. Here it's quite nasty actually, because we do have here like Thriving Rhino, which is a good card, but I just don't think. Okay, I think I'm gonna go like all in with this artifact plan. I'll just take the artifact 3 drop in here and really hope to get some kind of improvised stuff, because this deck will definitely play a lot of artifacts, and I do want to have things like Fenhauler, which I think I'm going to pick here. Yeah, I don't need this kind of an effect here. I definitely take the Fenhauler because I have kind of set up myself for this kind of stuff, so pretty easy pick here, I think. Okay, Cloudblazer, but I have only one Prism now currently, so I'm not going to pick it. It would be a nice thing to splash, but I'm already splashing red and I'm already playing black. Maybe it's just a splash as well, but we have here a perfectly reasonable pick in the Trophy Mage. I have already three mana spells that I'm quite likely to play all of them, so I'll take the Trophy Mage there. I won't be needing that many more 3 drops though, so I should kind of maybe prefer to fill my curve. Like, well, I guess it's fine. I mean, I have only one 4-drop creature, but I do have other 4 mana spells. I think the Crusher just isn't gonna make the cut. I have like these 2/1 power creatures. Yeah, the Crusher isn't gonna be in the deck. Here it's gonna be a Malfunction or the Sky Ship Plunderer, not the Whirler of Invention, because it's just too expensive. At least 3 blue, and there's nothing amazing to get with it. I guess the specification array could be something like okay, but I take this the excellent 2-drop. I don't even care about not being able to multiply my counters, although I can, I guess, get more energy. But 2 mana, 2/1 flyer, it's just a very nice stats, so I'm gonna pick that. And here it's gonna be a decision between, I mean, it could be like another Peafowl here. I wouldn't mind to pick the card draw here actually, because I haven't seen the blue implements here, so I think I'd rather take this blue card draw than this black one here. I don't have any 5 mana cards here. I guess these can be quite often 5 mana, but I'll take the card draw now because I do want to have at least one of those here, so I don't need to risk. I don't have to worry about it anymore now that I have picked it. Okay, though, so there is the Live Fast. There is a Revoke Privileges for some reason as well. This Assistant, is that gonna be a good one? I don't think. I'm not particularly fond of returning any of these my artifact creatures or the implement here. It could be a defensive card. Yeah, I think I'll take the defensive card here, and I guess that's one way to also multiply counters on my things. It would be quite nice to play this on turn 1, this on turn 2, and then I can start making this go quite big. Okay, Fenholler is gonna be the pick here. I really want to have more of these kind of payoffs for playing those artifacts, so pretty easy pick here. And here there is not really anything. I mean, this would be a nice sideboard card, but again, it is best of one, so I'll just, like, I don't think I'm gonna play the intruder either. Red is just a very light splash here, so I'll take the uncommon anyway. You know, wild value. There is now a Tesseract's Ambition. How about the Metallic Rebuke? I'm not a fan of counter spells in limited in general, so I'll just take the uncommon. I mean, I'm not gonna play it. This is a best of one. If this was best of three, I would have picked it at least for sideboard purposes, but not gonna main deck in this format. I guess I can take like the Sky Reservoir Walker. I don't think I'm gonna play it, but or any of those, but I had to pick something. I don't like the 0-4 either, so okay, now I'm not gonna play two of Tesseract's Ambition, so now I'll take the Rebuke. Okay. And I got the last pick, P-File. That I might actually be playing. Okay, so we have here Mana Fixing. This is the perfect one because I'm gonna just splash for. I have the black implement and black 2-drop. If I don't play either of these things, then I'm gonna also splash for black. But anyway, what I was saying that if I had like a black was somehow my another main color, then this would be the perfect land because I do want to have a dual land that has my one of my main colors and one of my splash colors, because that means I need to run fewer mountains in here. We do have the Prophetic Prism, we do have the Counterband Kingpin, would be nice pickups here, but I'll take the Mana Fixer because I really want that my mana is always as perfect as possible. And here we just pick the Mythic Rare for our collection. It's not possible to splash a double casting green card. I would take the Foundry Inspector like immediately. This would be great for my deck. I mean, it would be amazing for my deck, but the point of these drafts at this point is that I want to fill my Kalidas Remastered collection. Like I was said, each Mythic Rare I pick means that I need to open on average seven fewer packs. So basically this equals kind of 7 packs as a price in that sense. Okay, but also expertise. Of course, Essence Extraction would be nice if I had black as my secondary color, which is not, it's unclear yet, and regardless, this is the better card. This is an amazing card, in fact, so very nice pickup here. And Clint Nest Crane is my pick here, I think. And I think it's pretty easy. I still don't have an amazing amount of 2-drops. There is a Dai Young, but I think in here I might just, because this is not an exciting removal, this basically deals 2, I mean it doesn't deal damage, but it gets rid of 2 toughness creature unless you have help from some other energy producing cards. I don't have many of those, so the Clint Nest Crane is gonna be my 2-drop of choice. Oh, there's another Crane, there's also a Chandra's Revolution, and there is an Earth Swooper, so okay, I want all of these. The amount of removal in this deck isn't that amazing. There's 16 creatures, although there are creatures I'm gonna cut regardless. But I think, as good as it is, do I still want to play this Chandra's Revolution here? Okay, I think I take the Swooper here, because I do have a 4 mana cards. If I play the double P-Fall, this makes, I already have a 2 Fenholders here, and one of these Serpents, so this actually, I really benefit from early artifacts, and this really is going to give me an early artifact so often that I just couldn't really. Chandra's Revolution, excellent card, but I didn't pick it now. This is good, but my red splash is such a slight one that now that I didn't pick the Revolution, I'll take the Malfunction as a sort of replacement 4-drop removal. 4 Artificers is not that great. I can't get anything that great with that thing. I don't think I'm, well, I guess there's some, no, but there, this is a form of trick or whatever, how you call it, utility card of some kind. I take the goggles, but I don't really think it's gonna be in the deck when all is said and done. I'll take this, but double implement doesn't seem very likely. Shipwreck Moray is not what I'm looking for here. I mean, neither is the Ally Strangler here. I have here enough force. Like, two of these P-Fouls is more than enough. So I guess I take the 3-drop, but unlikely to play it. Eager Construct, on the other hand. Yeah, I can play it. It's an artifact for my few payoffs. I do have basically three big payoffs, and I guess the ambition, it only requires one artifact, so it's not such a consideration in there. Well, let's take this. I mean, I guess I could have taken the puzzle knot, but again, this is just a best of one, so I'm not gonna main deck the red puzzle knot, even though I am splashing for red here. Okay, there's quite a few cuts I'm gonna make. I haven't really picked a card that I know I'm surely not gonna play. So, well, let's get rid of the, now we have some time. Well, we don't have some time now. It's, the draft is done now. So, I mean, these cards are now in my not in my deck, so none of them will be going to my deck. So that's that. And then I'll just quickly go through these cards. So maybe it's easier for you to read them. Just pause the video. And I'm gonna cut a majority. I mean, I have 50, that's 11 cuts here, basically. 11 of these we need to go. Yep, okay. So, let's click here to see the actual... No, actually one of the cards was a land, so this actually means... Well, I don't know what did I say, why did I say 11 there, but... I still need to cut 11, right? Because now it's 34 in here, so 11 away, it's 20, 23, and okay, yeah, so 11 cuts. So barrels, I don't want to cut any of this high end. These are my only high end. I need to be able to win somehow, so I'm playing these. I'm also gonna play all the fours. I like two malfunctions, two P-Fouls, and the Chandra's Revolution, kind of like a five mana spells. The rest are cheaper. This is of course just a off-color card that goes away right away. These three drops, yeah, Ally Stranglers are gonna leave. Rebuke can be cut right away. This is an off-color card. I would like the turtle in here because I have this nice little bit of synergy with the where is it? That goes away, by the way. This plunderer here, and now it's gonna be pretty easily. The goggles have to go. How many creatures? 16 so far, so I can cut some creatures. Still 5 cuts, that is quite a lot, in fact. Well, at least, yeah, okay, I can easily cut two of these Implement of Malices. So basically, not 5 actually, because I have the land in here already, so there are 2 cuts I need to make. And I think I know what those 2 cuts are. The Aether Poisoner and the Implement of Malice are so far the only cards that really require me to have access to black mana very early in the game. So if I cut the Poisoner and the Implement of Malice, my mana is gonna be perfect. I basically have only 2 black cards, 2 red cards. None of these require me to have access to their colors like early in the game. So mana will be perfect here. Well, I mean, perfect and very good at least. I'm very satisfied for my color because I have the prism and this helps with the red spells. So it's gonna, there's enough fixing to make this work. Yeah, there's really no reason to consider cutting anything else. I have artifacts in the end 8, and 8 means that I'm quite often going to be able to pick something up with this. And if not, then the 1-3 flyer is still acceptable. Okay, yeah, I mean, I don't really want to cut any of these. Artifacts are important because of these 3 high-end cards, and then the rest of the cards are just actually just the good quality cards in this deck. So, okay, there is the Pillar Bug times 2 and the Weltfast Monitor, which also want to have access to the colors, but I mean, I will pretty easily make the mana base so that I can have the access to those colors somewhat soon on average. So yeah, this is the deck without the rest of the lands, and now let's see what's the minimum amount of blue I need to play in here. I mean, I'm looking at 10 blue sources at minimum, so I'm gonna add like and not counting this prism, because I want to have blue on turn 2, not only on turn 3 when this prism is able to produce blue. So let's take like the Bob Ross lands here. 9 of these for sure. That's 10 blue producing lands. And there's still 7 left. So if I put like one more, and I could have 3 and 3. But then again, I have these. So basically, if I now put 3 mountains and 4 swamps, that's going to be 5 sources for both red and black. 5 is very good. I mean, considering I'm supposed to draw at least one of the 5 sources in the top half of my decks, for example. And most often in like five, if it's not in my opening hand, then like in my first 5 or 6 turns, that's going to be enough. So I'm gonna keep the 10 blue sources, and this is the 11th if really my starting hand is only mountains and swamps, and it's otherwise keepable. I can still, if one of the cards is the prism, then that's fine. I can play the prism on turn 2 and then continue playing my blue spells. So what did I say? four of the swamps, Bob Ross, and then 3 mountains. So thanks to this Spire Bluff canal, this is actually quite a nice balanced mana base. I really like picking any kind of dual lands in limited formats. The formats where there are those common Ender's tapped dual lands, I pick those very highly. I think it's very important to minimize the kind of mulliganing and color issues you have in limited games. So I pick these kind of lands very highly, which is easier to see, of course, in formats when we have common duals. Yep, this is going to be the deck, and let's go. I think the deck is quite good. It has like a good early game. It has decent mana curve, it has some removal, and it has some finishing cards that are capable of finishing games. But this starting hand, do I want to go like Pacification Array, tap something, I'm on the play at least, then maybe Malfunction and maybe Tesseract's Ambition at some point. I mean, I guess I can afford doing that. This is not a easy keep. I could easily see mulliganing this. But I should draw like playable spells, because I mostly have blue spells and artifacts, and then not many of them cost like 4 or more playable spells, or at least a 4th land, and I can still tap something if I don't have anything else to do with my mana. So I will actually keep this. But if someone wants to mulligan this, I definitely, I'm not gonna argue against it. I think it was like a keepable hand, but also a hand you could mulligan. Okay, well that is good thing. I get to play a 3-drop here. So now the hand is in fact very nice. I guess it doesn't matter really what tapping that thing, but now, if I didn't draw like this 3-drop, I of course would have tapped this on their upkeep, but since I did draw the pillar bug, I'm just gonna play it. If they have some big guy, I might be able to malfunction it. Do they make it a 4-4 or a 3-3? Okay, now this is gonna enter tapped, of course, so I can't do anything else than tap down the thing. Yeah, there's no reason to. I mean, I guess I could tap it and go attack for 2 lifelink. Then I would go to 22. They would attack with at least 4, perhaps 5. So no reason to do that. I just tap the 3-3 here, so they cannot attack really. So now I do have all my removal spells active in here. But of course they are, I cannot double spell in here, so I need to consider. Well, I mean, it all depends on. Okay, that died. All depends on what they're gonna play. Well, they played. They are not gonna add any pressure to this board anymore. I'm not really that sorry about losing that tapper, because I really am not gonna be able to easily use the 2 mana for it. Of course, it would have been great for the Fenholler, but nothing much I can do about it now. So I think I will save the Welding Sparks for mana efficiency reasons, and I will use the Chandra's Revolution. Now this can tap down anything, even no matter the toughness, and I can now also kind of deny them a bit of. Well, this will produce green. This will. I don't think it matters too much, and they have the map too. So, but anyway, they will have at least a little bit less total mana now available than when I tap this thing. I definitely want to draw a land here rather than anything else. I probably just would want to kick off with the Tesserit's Ambition and then try to get some double spells happen. Because if they are going to able to add some more pressure here, one spell per turn might be a bit awkward here. At least the Welding Sparks currently deals 4 damage. This can tap down anything. Okay, that. But I might just be killing here. Yeah, I think I'll just. I mean, it would be nice to take the scry, but I think I'll just rather kill this, gain 2 life, and deal 2 damage here. I still have the malfunction for one of the guys. I hope they don't have like a handful of big creatures here. I do have my own 5/5 that is gonna enter at some point, but we'll see when that happens. Okay, hasty guy. Well, I'm still at 20 now, so I'm gonna take here. Then, okay, I'm gonna take only 3 because they want to have the mana for something else. At least they have only 2 cards left, so maybe the Fenholler will be a good blocker here. I mean, of course, they have the Pacification Array there, so this won't be a good blocker. But this is a fine turn here, because I get to play two spells here. I have blockers for these things, and I get some. Well, both of us get the scry. I'm gonna keep. Well, I mean, let's see. If it's a land, I'm gonna keep it. But if it's a spell, it really depends on. And this is not the kind of spell I'm gonna keep here. Even though this could make me more energy, I could get like an extra token with the swooper. But it's not really what I want now. How about their choice? Their choice is scry to bottom as well. So yeah, I'm not gonna attack. Obviously, they're gonna tap something down. Now I don't actually care about what it is. I'm gonna trade with one of their things anyway. I'm not gonna trade with the swooper, obviously, because it's gonna create me a 1/1 thing, which a 1/1 thing is excellent at blocking these 2/1s here. But this construct is gonna go, even though it's gonna make my improvised guy cheaper. I'm not gonna willing to take so much damage here. Yeah, this is fine. Now they only have 4 mana available here. Alright, so let's see. Yeah, I'm gonna just attack with the swooper. If they let me, of course. They might not let me. It would be reasonable to not let me, actually. And now I cannot play the Fenholler, of course, because I did that. If I didn't trade now, I could use the 5 mana and 2 other artifacts to play it. And now I don't get the artifact from here, so I'm not gonna be able to play the Fenholler. But this is still a fine turn, I mean, playing this. I can also malfunction this. It's important to remember this is an artifact, enchant creature or artifact. So if I feel like they don't play any big creatures, I can just tap this down. But let's see. I can actually double spell next turn if I want to. We'll see how it happens. And the Cobra, do I trade with the Pillar Bug? I mean, I'm gonna play this at 7 mana. I don't need artifacts for this thing. I have the 7 mana available. In a couple of turns I can just slam this down. And I do want to get rid of this Cobra before I have the Fenholder, if at all possible, because, of course, well, actually, no, this cannot block this. No. So, but still, I don't think there's not much value in taking two in here, because this won't be able to go through this 1-3 anyway. I mean, yes, it can gain some life, but I'll trade with the Cobra if they are gonna attack with it. They don't attack with it. Okay, so I mean, first I'm gonna let them tap the Swooper, of course, because they're gonna do that, and if not, it would be good for me. And then I'm gonna not attack because I might just, well, it is interesting, in fact, it really is. There are several options in here. I could just like malfunction this Tapper and play the Plunderer, then I would have 3 power in the air. And then later on play this Fenholder, maybe cheaper, I would be able to double spell, because I can also just now play this by tapping the Pillar Bug. But regardless, I'm not going to attack with this, because I'm not going to be able to have the mana to activate the lifelink. So no reason to attack, they can just block with this or trade with this, I'm not going to gain the life anyway. So this means that I'm going to... Yeah, I think I like this quite much, because the Tapper is probably the... Tapper is probably the biggest, I mean, most problematic card in their board currently. So hopefully they don't draw some sick creature right away. But now they are unable to tap, so I can create my 1-1 and then I have to count my mana. Can I next turn play like land, Weltfast Monitor and the Fenholder if I have 3 artifacts? That's not, I'm not scared about that thing. I think I'm 1 mana short. Actually, I'm not. So if they attack with the Cobra now, I am not going to block. Because... And they didn't. Because I basically drew all my removal here. Welding Sparks, Chandra's Revolution, double malfunction. Pretty funny. So let me see. There's actually one thing of consideration here. It really is. If I don't now make the token, that means... I can start making more energy for myself. But if I make the token, I can actually play this. I mean, I can play it anyway. I don't need to play the Weltfast Monitor. So yeah, this is definitely what I'm going to do. Because I have the Plunderer here, I'm not going to make the token. I'll go to 3 energy. And the next turn I can make the token and I still have 1 energy and I can make one more. So I think that is the correct decision here. I'll decline this. Let's see if they have a removal. No. So I'll just do it like this. And now I don't need to play the monitor. I wouldn't be able to cast the Fenholder. But now I'll just hard cast this. Why not? Now this monitor doesn't really do much in this board. They can double block with 2 1-3s and that's it. So completely unnecessary to think about that. But then again, this Fenholder can't be blocked by these artifact creatures. Whether they jump or take 5, both are very good outcomes for me. And now that I have this yet another malfunction here, if they have a good non-artifact blocker, a big thing, I can just tap it down as well. So this draw from me has been just excellent. No reason to tap down anything currently, no reason to attack with the Pillar Bug in here, so I'm just going to go for the attack with all these guys, and then I can make a token, and then the Plunderer might be able to make me another energy. I think the Fenholder is their biggest problem right now. Of course the Flyers can be, but will be problematic too. Because my clock will be, well, it's not super fast now, but except that if they take this, my clock is very fast now. So, what does this mean? Well, those colors I don't think have any kind of mass removal, so I can just play all my stuff in here. Except, of course, the malfunction, because it doesn't really have a reasonable target. Next turn they're gonna have to block the Fenhauler. So they can do that. Okay, well that's only dealing two, so I lost my two power flyer. I still have a one power flyer. And now they still don't have a good block, because even if they triple block, it's only four damage here. And they played the land, so I don't have to even fear about any kind of trick. They still had one red green mana open there. So I don't think there's still any reason to... Yeah, this is just gonna trade all this. Yeah, they have two... Yeah, there's no really reason to use the malfunction for anything. I'll just attack for six damage. Of course, they're gonna have to jump block their Fenhauler, but that's very good for me. Because when they have jump blocked a bunch of times, then actually I can start attacking with my other guys. So they'll just get rid of the 2-1, it's fine. I still don't think that I can do that next turn. I mean, attack with everyone next turn. That's a bit too early. When they have only 1-1-3 left, then I might just consider attacking with all. Okay, so they're gonna have some kind of revolt thing. I don't care, I take 2 damage here. I take 3 damage here. Because now I can attack with a bunch of my guys. Yeah, there's that. Although now that I knew they are gonna have a revolt thing, I could have just blocked them anyway. Especially this 1-1, there was a free token, because I have the malfunction here. Okay, but now I'll see that I'm simply going to tap this down and attack with everyone. Gonna menace this guy. So is it gonna be a lethal damage? I don't even know. I'm still gonna... I don't think they can block the one... Yeah, they can't block the 1-1, because then it would be lethal. So they have to block the Hauler with one of them, and then the Pillar Bug with one of them, and take 5 damage here. Okay. So they would have been at 1, and then it would have been trivial to win from them. But yeah, I actually should have considered blocking there. But then again, they could have had something like a trick or something. Taking the 3 damage wasn't really a big deal. Okay, that was the match number 1. Well, 4 islands, but I'm on the draw, 2 drop, for, yeah, I'm gonna keep this. Even the 5th land was good because of the Tesseract's ambition, but, I guess that was fine too, because now I have the black spells are out, I mean, not kind of out, but they are cards, I can, if I draw them, I can play them. And that was a good draw, so... So Clint Nest Crane is gonna get countered. Yeah, it is. Okay, well then, let's not get another flyer and card advantage. I would have hit this, and I would have been even able to actually cast it. Well, I mean, if they had a counter spell, they had a counter spell. Well, they can't counter this because I have 3 mana available, and the Revolutionary Rebuff doesn't even work against the artifact spells. So. What are they gonna play here? Malfunction that. That's fine, I will just draw 3 cards. Draw 3 cards here, definitely. I have a couple of artifacts, in fact, so... Nice. Nice refill there, and they have only 4 cards left. I have 5 spells. I guess this is just a cantrip, but... Okay, they are just passing. They, of course, can have a... Fumigate in there, so I need to pay attention to that. First... No reason to do anything than attack. I guess I could play the Prism first. I'm not sure if I want to play the Fenhauler, because they could easily have a Fumigate. It seems like they have a Fumigate. Or then they are just flooding out or have like counter spells. Okay, I will play this thing first, because now that means I will have a Welding Sparks up if something weird happens. I don't think this format has flash creatures really. but we'll see. At least I have the option to cast a Welding Sparks. But man, is it gonna be a... I mean, I have the Welding Sparks here, so... I mean, well, yes, I do have it, but I have the Fenholler as a kind of finisher type of spell. And I'm not gonna just try to attack 2 per turn. I need to over... not overextend, but extend a bit, even if I suspect they're gonna have a Fumigate. And actually, they did have a Torrential Gearhulk. Well, that explains... That's... But that was gonna get... At least it's better that it got like a this than my Fenholler. But now they have two big guys and I have only... No, I do have answers for both. Well, that's nice. Do I want to answer them both now that they are tapped out? Because I do want to get rid of these. 1, 2, 3 artifacts means this is gonna deal 6. And then I have the malfunction and I do have mana for that too. 7 mana. Alright, this is good. 1, 2, 3 artifacts. This is 6 damage. Which one do I want to leave there? I think the Gearhulk is can be bounced and I don't want that to happen, so I'll kill that and I will tap down this guy. And next turn I can play my... I no longer fear about the Fumigate. The reason they were just playing that way, they had the Gearhulk and probably not that much else. Oh, that's good. Well, at least I'm glad I killed this and rather with these Welding Sparks. So they can play this on next turn, but they can't... Well, sadly they can block their 5-5, but at least they can't attack... Well, they can make it unblockable. Yeah, well, there's not much else here to do than attack with this guy in right now. Can play the Eager Construct and the Fenholler here. Take action, and this is... Yeah, Flyer. Flyer is good. And, what do they scry? They kept that. So I can just use, like... Yeah, the Prism is the artifact I'm gonna tap here. So while this thing can block this guy... at least... Oh, my Flyer isn't that great now. There's no reason to attack. I just have to trade with this Wooper in here. And hope to draw, I guess, my second malfunction here. Chandra's Revolution. Oh, that's good. They have... Well, yeah, they have exactly one. Well, I did draw my card draw spell, so I don't really need to play my lands here. I'm gonna just be able to... I'm not gonna be able to draw more than one card a turn, so I don't need to show that I'm very low in action here. So this is nasty. It can just trade with the Plunderer, so I'm not able to attack with anything. They did have this, so basically I need to draw the malfunction to make it so that this Fenholler could attack. This is a stalemate now, because they don't have good attacks except with the Serpent, but when they attack with the Serpent, they lose the ability to block it. But they do have, of course, non-artifact creatures in here, so they have 3 attacks, and then they win in 3 attacks. So I think they're gonna win this game if I don't draw something very good. Even if they don't draw anything, if they draw just land here, I'm not gonna win this game unless I draw something good. Yeah. Wouldn't have been bad to draw the Chandra's Revolution there, because they didn't have any mana to return this thing. I would have been able to get rid of the 1-1 flyer and also the aura here. But now this is the moment of truth. If I don't draw the malfunction, I can't win the game. I'm not gonna like pass turn and see if they're gonna do that. Of course they're gonna do that, so I just save time by doing this. So yeah. They had Yeah, to be able to bounce the. Yeah, well, that is the risk in this format. I mean, I guess in most formats, it's a risk of aura-based removal that they can just bounce the enchanted creature, or of course, just remove the enchantment. But in this format, we also have this white common 2-2 that can just doesn't really require anything. When it enters the battlefield, you can, if you want to, return any of your permanents to your hand. So aura-based removal is a risky, but that's not the reason to kind of not play malfunctions. Malfunctions were, for example, excellent in the first match. Alright, this is a fine hand. If I had the Plunderer here, it would be amazing to get to multiply these counters here, but I have like a defensive one drop. I can play this now and I can make it a 1-4, and then, well, I'm assuming I'm either drawing something that I can play or at least a fourth land here, so. And that was the fourth land, so that means that I might miss my turn 3 play, but I will not miss any plays after that. And Scry will help me. They scry on the bottom. And I have my turn 3 play here as well. Not the greatest, but I'm still gonna play it. Yeah, no attack. I wanna just block it. I'm not gonna trade it with the world fast monitor, of course, so. Okay, then there's the peafowl, and I might be able to have the ambition here. Yeah, I'm not going to malfunction that, I don't think. I will take 3 damage a turn from it, because next turn I'm going to draw 3, I think. But then, turn after that, I can start jumping this guy. So I will go to 14 on the following turn. Yeah, I need to refill here. Need to refill. I need to use the 5 mana for that at some point anyway, so. That was a perfect time for that, and then I can just start to play out my spells that actually have some kind of effect on the board. So no red mana yet. I'm afraid that if they are gonna have some kind of a vehicle there, I'm gonna start taking a lot more damage. So I have access to 6 mana. I could. Well, it's not a Fenhall turn yet. Or is it? I still couldn't jump. I do want to be able to jump this now, so maybe it's just gonna be a pillar, but then it's pillar bug and nothing else. But the next turn I can play the Fenhaler, and I can, because I would take it yet another 3 damage in here. I'm not sure I'm a fan of that. And if they have something like removal for the Fenhaler, they can just attack. Yeah, I can't take that risk. I play the pillar bug now and nothing else. And let's see what they have. Now at least I can trade my artifacts for the infiltrators here. Okay, they didn't have anything for the peafowl. That is good. Now I got my red mana available too. And this also makes the Fenhaler a bit cheaper here. So it's now I'm gonna have to tap 5 lands. Oh, but I might still want to. Maybe I just want to kill the Screech here, actually. But I still can't play the Welding Sparks and the Fenhaler here. So maybe it's gonna be like. Maybe I'm gonna offer. No, I don't wanna offer any trade yet. I mean, I guess I could just malfunction it as well. And start attacking with my. So let's see, if I do this. If I do, okay, I guess I'll have to go for it now. So I'm gonna do it like this for improvise. And I guess 1, 2, 3, and I need 1 island here. Yeah, this is a bit risky if they have the removal for the fen hauler, but I don't think it's that big a rip because I still have the 2/4 can also block the 3/2s. If they have like a removal for the fen hauler, I don't think they have. They could have like a combat trick in addition to that, but that would be just. I mean, I can't play around everything, and this was just perfect. Now I will remove this fen hauler here. I can just use a malfunction for it, and then I will start attacking with my own fen hauler here. And I have another one of these guys here too. But first, I'll just use the fen hauler. I can leave the welding sparks as an instant speed thing here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I could play the other fen hauler too if I kind of tap everything. I don't think I'm gonna do that though. Double block is certainly fine here. I don't mind if they double block with any of those. And now I'll just leave the welding sparks up rather than play the another fen hauler. I can play the fen hauler next turn. Unless they have there another big guy, which I'm gonna have they do. So I have the malfunctions for those. That's pretty nice. Pretty nice in fact, yeah. I might even consider raising here, because I can just attack with this and take three here. Here I think it's gonna be because I have of course a lot of artifacts. This is just a more mana efficient play. Now I can play the fen hauler and oh, also that. I think I can play them both. Yeah, this is pretty good. So let's see. This, well, I play this anyway, I mean, of course. And I do have, yeah, I do have this. So, fen hauler is gonna do like this. I guess this. Well, yeah, I don't have the flying blocker here, but I don't care about the 3 damage here now because I'm really. Look at these guys. Yeah, they don't stand a chance. I still had the malfunction left here. Well, I just drew all my finishers, and they didn't have anything aggressive. They didn't have any removal really either. So that was pretty easy cruising there. I quite like the how this draft turned out. I didn't have any massive amount of artifact synergies like I picked very early this serpent. Was it even my second pick? This is a fine hand. And I didn't see any serpents after that, I don't think. So I would have definitely picked more of those. But still, because I had got a double fen hauler, this archetype seems to be at least something different here. I did force artifacts, of course, somewhat. But it turned out quite nice. So that's gonna die. No, it's not. Well, I do have a blocker for that. Oh, let's just show that I have all the mana in here. Well, I have the prism too, so I basically had everything there. So if they don't have any trick or removal, they can't really attack with the chaser. If they attack with it, I'm definitely not blocking because I have the welding sparks here for the next turn, and they will get 1/1 anyway if they attack, so I can't prevent that from happening. I also have a life linker in here, so I might just actually attack back and gain 2. We'll see. And if they have removal, they might be interested in also in removing the plunderer, I guess, but maybe their life linker is, yeah, it might be just annoying to them, so they might want to get rid of that after all. They could have like a welding sparks. Or why not that? But the good thing about that thing is that my improvise and guessing a serpent business is still gonna be. This is gonna help them. Also, welding sparks will now be pretty much permanently deal 4 damage at least. Well, at least actually 5. Let's play these. I don't need welding sparks here. Oh, that's like a lot of land here. I can't block here, so this is actually. Well, they can attack only for 3. I'm not gonna die yet, but I'll just actually shift to enter in here. I don't know reason to present something I don't have. Because this lifelink is gonna ask me from at every priority, do I want to activate. This revoke privilege doesn't prevent creature activation, only they can't crew vehicles. So I will drop to 15 at least now. And I need two welding sparks, most likely the salivating gremlins, but of course I would like to just draw something. Well, I did draw something, but that's actually not gonna block anything than the 1-1. Yeah, I mean, kinda sad to draw a 3-drop now, because I'm just 1 mana short of double spelling. Problem is that if they have an artifact, this is gonna hit for 4. This is gonna be 6. And if they have like a multiple artifacts, that's even worse. Of course I can just trade it with the monitor, but I mean, I guess, yeah, if they have like artifacts and removal or a combat trick, it's not so easy decision here, but okay, I guess I'll just do this right now. I don't want them to have any kind of boost spell to save it. Because I think I have quite a few good draws in here. I mean, those 5-5s and 5-6 and things like that. I will just try to... I'm not gonna try to raise, I'm trying to just stabilize and keep my life total at a reasonable amount. Of course, they are red-white, so that I should be expecting, for example, the 5-drop eagle. 5-drop eagle there that pumps their team, and if they have that, I'm actually in a very bad shape here, because they're gonna get another 1-1 artifact here now. The infiltrator isn't great either, and now they can... Well, okay, they used up the energy there, of course, so... They can't jump anyone here. I do have the... Well, blocker, unless I just attack with it, of course. I did draw now a good one here, because... Let's see. If I play this for 3, yeah, then this will cost 4. No, that's exactly 1 short of double spell again. I will have 3 mana left after this, and that means that the serpent is still not gonna be able to be played, so I just play the serpent in here. Does that mean that I'm gonna simply... Yeah, I'm gonna attack with the plunderer. They might block. They might block, and if they do, that's fine. If they don't block, that would mean that they have the eagle there, but... Yeah. I mean... They're gonna save it for extra damage, yeah. So, have to play this instead. Okay, so I might be taking a ton of damage here now. Oh, that's bad. Yeah, well, now I am taking a ton of damage. And that's probably game there, because I'm gonna drop to, like... What, 3 life? Is it so? Yeah, I don't have any kind of a way to actually get out of this. Yeah, 3. I had blockers, they had removal from my blockers, and they had... And this again shows how good these are, these things that create... cheap creatures that can create more tokens. Because this damage really added up quickly in here. They got basically 2 tokens for free. So they really matter when I don't have like any kind of blocker there. If I had like a thriving turtle in there, that would have been amazing. Or any kind of creature. I guess I was a bit flooded there, but still. Okay, I'm 2-2 now, so ideally I would win the third match to get the 1000 gems reward at least, but we'll see. At least I did pick a mythic rare in this draft, so I'm one step closer to completing the set. I'm on the draw, but the hand is of course nice. Well, most hands are nice in best of one because of the starting hand algorithm, which is kind of necessary also because you don't really want to have your one game matches decided by mulliganing or keeping risky hands. Here it's gonna be the swooper just, and I will be on time. This will only happen at 7 mana, so I might be able to have some attacks in with the Kiaseka before they get to remove it. This is That's okay. I will here of course make the token here, and then it's going to be the, I mean, I guess it could be the prism to make this very cheap, very fast, but I still like the on curve play here better. I will choose out of these options. I have the prism, so I have the colors available. 2, 3. I think I'd rather have the, well, I'm not sure. Do I want to have like a defensive guy, the 2, 3 that has lifelink, or the offensive guy, 3, 2 that can get menace? That's interesting. I think I might want to actually have the menace instead. So next turn it's gonna be the P-file most likely, and turn 5, I'm pretty sure it's gonna be the prism and the monitor, and then this will be very cheap on turn 6. That's gonna get a counter. No, it doesn't. So I can offer the trade here. They're not gonna block, I'm sure of that, but definitely I don't mind if they do. I guess I could leave this to block this pioneer also. Yeah, okay, that might make more sense. Now that they didn't give the counter to it. Of course, I'm again facing a potential eagle in there, but there's not much I can do about it. So if I play the prism and the construct now, I don't have the fifth mana, but I wouldn't need it either, because this would cost only 4 next turn. But I think I still do this. I can try to maybe even be even more mana efficient with this thing. This is a good blocker if they don't have the eagle. 3-2 is blocked by that thing. Okay, so now I need one of my removals here. I have two malfunctions, and I also have a Chandra's Evolution doesn't work, but Welding Sparks would work because I have enough artifacts here, but well, I don't have them. So now I have to reconsider. Do I just play? I did draw the land, so the Serpent is a possibility in here. It's just too bad if they have something. 7 damage is a lot. I mean, I can first try to somehow jump block it. I mean, not jump block it, double block it, for example, with a 3-2 and a 2-2. And then when that fails, I can try to play the Serpent a bit cheaper. Yeah, and then this scry will help me slightly to get maybe like a closer to my removal. That's unnecessary because I do have the Prophetic Prism here. They will scry to where? Top. So this is kind of awkward here. I don't want to start taking 7 here, but they do have 3 cards still. So, they have, I mean, of course I could like a block with 1,000 cards, but they could have the white +2/+2 artifact creature. If it's an artifact creature, it's indestructible. So I think I just have to do it like this and take their first trick away, and then hope that the Serpent. Okay, that's fine. That's definitely fine. Because I actually did get the. This was only one card. This got me the monitor, so it wasn't even a 2-for-1 in that sense, because the Draffy Mage drew me the Belfast monitor. So now it's good. I have the refill here. That's the great part of this. So I can play the Giasika Serpent next turn, and then I have the refill available. And this thing says that it has to be a cheaper, lesser converted mana cost. So they didn't have anything there, so the Breaker didn't really return anything. And if any of these things die, it's not gonna trigger. So, I will start with this thing. And then I can. I don't quite. Yeah, I would need one more mana to put to double spell here, but a 3 mana Serpent is gonna be just fine. So they have the Plunderer. I have the blocker for it though. And here we see. I mean, I'm gonna probably just attack with the construct. Okay, By the way, I know I have this thing, so I have blue mana available here. Maybe they don't see it. Maybe the peafowl is actually gonna be a secret. Yeah, I'm gonna accept any trade they are gonna find from there, so I will now deal two here. Yeah, I don't really care. They could double block with the token and the edit trail hawk, in which case I will trade with the hawk. It's fine. It's just the ground guy 2-2. It did its job. Did its job. But they are, because they have stuck at 4 mana here. Yeah, I don't mind that at all. Because they are stuck at 4 mana, they are not gonna activate this Universal Solvent anytime soon here. So let's see if they miss out on the peafowl here. They might. Because thanks to Prophetic Prism, I can actually activate the flying ability. So they have three cards. At least two of those are non-lands. So they do have stuff going on. Alright. So they have a trick or they missed that I have this activation still available. And I'm definitely going for it. Yeah. I could have also blocked the hawk. It would have been safer a bit, but I liked it because it seemed like they really simply missed that I had the mana available there. So this can be a 4-1. So I don't really think. Well, let me see. If they make it a 4-1, they still have to double block with the Propeller Pioneer and the Shipwreck. This isn't enough. This can take 6. I mean, this can take 5. So this and this blocking is not enough. So I don't actually mind just attacking with this, even though without making it unblockable. And I have to think about the peafowl, because I'm starting the race right now, I think. Although they do have, they can jump this thing. Okay, I will have to leave the swooper to block the Propeller Pioneer here. Although I have this thing. Fine. I'll just do it like this. So I'm not gonna play the Ambition right now. I was considering playing the Ambition, hopefully drawing one land and then still have the Crane. But this thing is in my deck. I haven't seen the card. This is my fifth game already. Baral's Expertise. Haven't seen. Oh, I saw it now, but it's in the bottom of the library. All right. I'll just play these things now. So basically, I'm going to attack with this and the Gearseeker Serpent. And now that I have the 1-3 blocker here, I will also attack with that 1-2 there. And if they are going to make some kind of blocks here, it's fine. So they are gonna double block it, which is definitely acceptable to me. Because I have the Tesseract's Ambition, so I can refill here. And I have more win cons here. Also I do have here the current board state is something that I can use to deal damage quite nicely. They have only 1-1 and 1-2 so far. And 2, well now 3 cards in hand, but maybe they are going to start drawing lands at some point. That's not very good. So how they will scry here? Of course they can be holding like 5 mana cards there and they want the land. Well, anyway, they kept that. And I will keep that. Yeah, because I have the ambition to free fill anything anyway, so 2-1 flyer here isn't that bad. So these aren't very. I mean, I guess I have to use the mana. Yeah, I mean, I'm still not gonna play the Ambition. I'm just gonna fly with this thing and play my two spells. And next turn, I can Tesseract's Ambition here. And I'm gonna attack, I suppose, with everything here. Except the 1-1, of course. I can just trade with the Construct. It's not such a big deal. Yeah, they can double block, but I take the trades here. I have more Pillar Bugs coming up anyway. So let's see. So they scry to top, so it probably was the land, and now it probably is gonna be a 5 mana spell, and it's the eagle, but that attack is not a dangerous one. I take 2 here. Actually, I take... No, they shouldn't... I have the pillar back, but they can make it fly. Okay, sure. I take 4 at 15. It's definitely all fine. What is not fine, though, is that 3-3 is gonna prevent all my attacks here, so I need to draw a removal or one of my other big guys. I have all my removal still left here. So because of the prism, I don't have to worry about my mana usage that much. I will have only 2 mana available here anyway, so that's one of the removals. That's all fine there. They might be holding another one of those though, because they were holding 2. They still have a spell left in there. Anyway, there is no attack in here, so I'm not gonna attack. Swooper is fine. And now there's another piece of removal. Let's see what happens to this thing. And then I can start again. Now they have only actually 3 power in here, so I don't need to even make this thing fly. I can't attack with the 1-2 though, because they can double block it. 1-1 won't be. Yeah, these. And the 1-3 is, I guess, not useful now, because they can just block it without losing. But I can take the trade to any either of those things here, so this is going to be the attack. And I'm gonna leave the malfunction for something threatening in there. I guess you could also consider malfunctioning this at some point, but I don't think so. So the pillar bug is gonna die, and I'm gonna make them lose the Aether Swooper. Unless they have a trick, of course. I'll still give this thing a lifelink. I'm not gonna plan to use the malfunction here. So things look okay. There's no counters for anyone here, so can't take any benefit from that. So what is the final card? It's a 6 mana card. Yeah, it was a 6 mana card, and perfect with this stat. So well, I mean, I can still yeah, that's again the aura-based removal has its flaws. But I still have good stuff going on. I can get rid of the... I can block either one of those. I can get rid of one of the flyers here. And then like, I have an out in here to deal with... of course the solvent can kill the malfunction too. So yeah, this is actually... Yeah, that was bad because they got rid of my other malfunction there. That is, in fact, bad. Now, if I attack with everyone that can attack, what does that mean? This thing will block the Plunderer. That's for sure. This thing will block, I guess, 1 damage here. This can block the 1-1 here. So they would take only... So I would. This would be get blocked, this would get blocked. This and this would go through that. So that's 3 damage and I lose the Plunderer here. That's not good. I need to wait for my removal. So yeah, this was bad. So because now they can solvent away their malfunction here. So they actually, well, not now, but when they draw the 7th land, and they will draw the 7th land before, I mean, I guess. Well, that's, they can get rid of the Peafowler. That's not really such a big deal. No. If I draw now like a Welding Sparks or Chandra's Revolution, it's good. I got another Peafowler, so this is a they're gonna wait for until they get the 7th mana, and then they get rid of the malfunction, and then I really need my Gearseeker 7th. No, it's dead. I need... What do I need here? I mean, I guess I could have my 5-5 improvised guys. That doesn't quite cut it. Yeah, the attacks just aren't there. Oh, I'm actually gonna lose this when they get this thing. Well, I guess I can double block this thing, yeah. Actually, I can, thanks to drawing this Peafowl here. Yeah, that's not really ideal. So I have what, 6, 10, 11 lands. So I have 6 lands. Well, yeah, I still got. Oh, that's horrible. Now this is bad. Now they were stuck at 4 mana for so long, and now the payoff is that they're actually. Because they have so many spells here compared to me, they have only, what, 7 lands versus my 11. Now this is a good draw, but sadly they have the Boilermaker in here, so at least they can't Solvent right now, so I can get rid of the Eagle. They also have a Swamp here in this deck, so I'll kill the Eagle, and they can make a Flyer here now. They have to do it now, but otherwise they can't. Yeah, do it later. So what does this mean? They have 2. Now I'm absolutely going to attack with everyone. Well, except with the 1-1, because they have an 0-3 blocker in here. Every flyer here is going to attack. It's not going to be a lethal or anything attack, but because they're going to block their Plunderer, I just will make the Servo token here now. So this is gonna take the Plunder and this is gonna block. So they will take 3 damage here, I think. And then they have a mana. Yeah, I still have a bunch of lands left in my deck, I think. 6 lands, it's 50-50 lands. Okay, so I did draw a decent amount of spells after all in here. But I do have 2 of my 5-5s. They conceded. So I didn't actually count the situation, but is it really so that they didn't have a, they had like 2 flying blockers. They weren't gonna die there because they could have blocked the 1-3 and the 2-4. I guess that would have been a jump block for the 2-4 in here. They had the ground covered, so I think they had a turn in there, but I guess the fact that this Chandra's Revolution jammed one of their lands can be very relevant, because they couldn't use the... Well, this would have been quite slow too. Okay, whatever it is, they did concede there. I was, after all, it seems like I was winning in there, and now I got my 3rd win, so 1000 gems at least. Yeah, that was quite close. I would like to go first with this hand, but at least I might be able to cast Baral's Expertise once, at least once in this draft. That is good, because it's such an excellent card that this can easily lead to in an even board situation, you can just win. That is a nice card, but I did draw the Malfunction. I might be able to get rid of it. At least they didn't have a 2-drop, so not too much pressure coming up in there. And if they make some tokens with this, I can just bounce them too. Okay, so they can just make a... They're going to just make a 1-1 here, I guess. I will Trophy Mage, and I will get the... Definitely the Menace guy, I think. I'd rather be the aggressor here. With the Baral's Expertise, I can easily be on the... racing side of the things. Of course I don't have the red mana yet, but I think I'm gonna draw the red mana sooner or later. I don't need a 2-3 blocker here. Next turn, I mean, I guess I can still consider just malfunctioning this before they get to 5 mana, but I do like the idea of just bouncing a bunch of their guys too. We'll see. Are they on a double malfunction? So what does this mean? They can make another token in there, and they can trade with the Trophy Mage in that case. Which wouldn't be that bad for me. I mean, yeah, that Trophy Mage dies in that case, but so what? I'm not gonna attack with this, of course, because they can just eat it with the 1-2. But I don't mind that they weren't interested in any of that. Now it's gonna be the Weltfast Monitor, and let's see what else it's gonna be. So now it's gonna be interesting. Because if they pass now, and this is great. Because I have here a pretty nice play available. I can Barrels Expertise all these three. They will respond by making the token. But when the Barrels Expertise resolves, this will be bounced. The token will be on the battlefield, and I can cast this for free. And then I can attack for like a 7 damage here, and they have nothing here. And that's the risk they took when they went all in with this game plan. Of course, it requires me having a pretty specific rare here, but this is gonna be great. Because I can't imagine they do anything else than they try to make a 3-3 in here now. Oh, actually I should maybe use the Welding Sparks because I don't have the... And this also fixes mana. Yeah, because I don't have the red source. Let's leave the malfunctions for later. Oh, that was better even. So now they're gonna be in some kind of trouble. That's not a good blocker, and if they have anything big, I'll just malfunction anything big. Like that exact thing. So this seems like I have the game here kinda almost wrapped up. I think I might even... No, I don't consider attacking with the 1-1. It might be relevant. If they are gonna jump with the thing, that's fine. Okay. So now one more malfunction and I'm probably... Might even win here. The red mana would be good at some point. Okay, that doesn't matter at all. Well, this is interesting. This is interesting indeed. I'm kind of interested in just malfunctioning this thing, forcing them to... Because if they have like Welding Sparks or something like that, it could be risky to attack with all. They can kill the trophy mage and eat this guy for free, for example. Of course, they do need to deal with this if they have removal. But if I don't attack with this, it's just stupid to attack with these guys. They can make a jump blocker. And then I don't necessarily want them to be able to scry right now. And I don't want to lose my tempo here by drawing cards. So I'm going to do this now. So let's see if they just can do the 1-1 here. And then it has to jump block the trophy mage. And now it also means that the 1-2 flyer will be lethal on the next turn, and I will also have two lethal ground guys. So they will need something pretty good in here. So they basically need to have a way to deal with each of these, or they need to gain some life somehow. Yeah, well, that was Barrel's Expertise in action. If I didn't have that, the game could have been a lot harder to navigate. So gold tier 1, so platinum is few wins away. And then the true ranking up starts. Again, I'm still not sure if I'm gonna try to grind to mythic, but I guess if I'm... When I get to platinum and I get some successful drafts, get a few tires quickly, yeah, well, then I might try consider it. This is a keepable hand, of course. And that's a nice 2-drop, too. Of course, I could have just played the prism, but now I have something even better here, so... And I'm gonna make this a 1-4, just in case if I draw the 2-1 flyer that... Okay, that's fine, too. The 2-1 flyer, this thing, that could have... made multiple counters on this. But now that they did use the impeccable timing there, I can get two of these 1-1 tokens if I get also... Unless they can deal with it right now. So do I want to play the Pillar Buck rather than the Trophy Mage here? I guess the Pillar Buck is slightly better as a blocker, but if they have something I can just offer a trade here as well. So I think I'm gonna choose this. This also means that I can't get the kind of a bad bid scenario that I happen to draw both of these 3 drops before I play this, because next turn it's gonna be the P-fall, so it's, I don't know when I'm gonna play any other 3 drop in this game. Now that I have one of those, but against the red-white, I might still wanna have the lifelinker 2-3 rather than the 3-2. Maybe. I'm not exactly sure. But they have all these. The minis is pretty meaningless here, I think. So I'll just take another pillar bug. Yeah, I don't think the menace is very useful against these 1-1s and stuff like that. Okay, so that's gonna make my flyer unable to attack. I'll play the P-Foul. Well, there is that. Okay, so I'm not in a hurry to get the 1-1 token here, so I mean, I probably might end up killing the Sky Skiff at some point, but not now. And I can't even attack with this 2-2 in here, because this is a 2-3. Well, in that case, let's just do it like this. No attacks. They don't have anything going on here so far either. I guess they have the Eagle in there, so I might have to save this for the 3-3 flyer I'm suspecting they are gonna have. Now, yeah, that's a nice combination. They can get the trigger without attacking with it because they have a vehicle. Alright, so this... they're just gonna jump this guy. Okay, so they're dealing 5 here. So does that mean that the race is on? Because... right. So... thing is, if they have the Eagle, the 3-3 Eagle here, I'm in a bad shape. But if I let them continue this, have this thing, I can't really make any blocks. And if I can't make any good blocks in here, they're gonna kill me, so I would have to race. But if I go to race, I would have to get rid of the Wheelsmith. Which means that if they have the Eagle, I'm still in bad shape here. So maybe I just hope they don't have the Eagle, I kill the Wheelsmith and go for the offense here. I guess I can leave the Trophy Mage here as a blocker. Yeah. Because... well... maybe not. Oh, because I have a stuff here happening. Okay, yeah, I think I'm gonna just do like this. I do get the 1-1 here anyway, and I'm just gonna kill the Wheelsmith. Maybe right away. Yeah, of course, right away. I don't want them to get the free crew on that thing. At least force them to tap something. But now let's hope they don't have the Eagle. If they do, I need to... well, I guess I have the blocker for the Eagle. But I still take a lot of damage because they can... in response to the ability. Well, okay, there wasn't... well, okay, that doesn't mean they don't have the Eagle. They just might want to play more creatures before they have that thing going on. This is, by the way, a very nice... play for by them anyway. So I'm taking 5 here now. They still have one energy left to make someone to jump. I guess I could have considered having the P-Foul to be a blocker. I mean, that was something I, because I did have the leftover mana. It is true. All right so now we actually I have a 3-2, and I need to now leave this as a blocker, this guy. I can attack with the Trophy Mage. And I guess I'm just gonna play the Pillar Bug and leave one blue mana open. And I hope they don't have anything too good, because they really... if they have something good, I'm gonna lose. They kill this, or they have the Eagle. And I'm gonna be in a bad shape. At least, yeah, they have a answer for that thing, I think. Yeah. So this is very bad. Because they can also jump this guy, take care of 6. I take actually 8 damage here. No, they didn't attack with that guy. I wonder. I mean, and of course, I can block the 1-2 here, so it's fine. And I have the lifelink here now, so I'm not dead yet. I don't think. Well, that is pretty awkward now. So the pillar bug has to attack now just for me to be able to gain 2 life. I think I'm gonna attack with the Trophy Mage as well. This 1-2 flyer will be blocking this Editrill Hawk here. They are not gonna block, they are likely to jump this guy. So they are gonna have a flying damage 2, 5, 6. They can deal 8. So I would have to actually jump block the Pioneer in here. Even when I. Yeah, but that's the only thing I can do here. The array is okay too. But I can't, because this is stuck, I can't tap and gain life. That's a problem. Alright, so this is a difficult decision here. I think I have to do it like this. No, actually, I forgot that they haven't used the last bit of bomb. What? They can't jump the artisan. I mean, why did I think that they still have the jump available? I'm stupid. Of course they don't. So it's better now. I don't have to jump block here. Don't have to jump block, and I will play the constructor. I mean, they get the scry too, but this is just not too slow. I need to add to the board because I can try to race now too. So let's see. That can be useful. I mean, it's probably better than a random card. So, I mean, if I knew it was like a removal spell specifically, then they kept on top, by the way. That could be bad. But yeah, they can attack for 5 here, unless I jump block. And of course, that does mean that if they have a. Okay, well, now I have to. They did have the eagle. And now everything gets a. That's the problem here is in terms of the race, everything has vigilance. So I just have to do like this, and then I have to do like this. I guess I might just trade with it. But yeah, I'm going to 2 now. Yeah, this eagle is just so good when they have so many creatures. And the vigilance is so bad because if it didn't keep vigilance, I could just attack. Well, I couldn't attack with lethal with this power, this board here, but. Would have been still nicer to be able to maybe attack somehow. Anyway, I can tap one of their things. I can gain 2 life and lose this guy in the process because they'll just block with the eagle, of course. I mean, I guess it's possible they don't block with the eagle if they are thinking about some kind of trick I might have. So. But even if I gain 2 life and tap this thing, it's still enough. Yeah, they'd have the eagle that I was worried about all the time. It ended up being the card that won them the game. But that's fine. I picked one mythic rare, and I also got the amount of wins that makes the prices reasonable. And actually, I got the fourth win. I somehow forgot that. So it's actually 1400 gems. So I only lost 100 gems. I got 3 packs and 1 mythic rare out of that deal. So just maybe, let's see for now. I don't even recall myself how many mythics I'm missing here. So I won't be doing anything relevant here. So you can just bye-bye if you are not interested in this. But I guess I'll include this in the video. I probably make some kind of a video at some point explaining more detailed what I mean by collecting these sets by drafting. So that will be in a separate video at some point. But here we see that, well, the Sculpting Steel is not opened from the packs. This is the card you can craft it, or you can of course gain these when you buy the big pack bundles. I think the 45 bundle and the 19 pack bundle should give 1 and 2 of these respectively. So let's not count this. That means we have 8, this is 9 per row, right? 9, 18 plus 4, 12, 22 mythic rares. And that means that the total amount of mythic rares in the set that you can collect is, excluding this sculpting steel, is 88. And currently I have here 4, 7, 10, 15, 20, 25, 29. And that's out of 88, which means that I still need 59 mythic rares. And for Kalades Remastered, the chance to for a rare to be a mythic rare in a pack is like 1 in 7. So 59 mythic rares, I have to multiply that with 7, right? So that's still like over 400 packs, isn't it? Yeah, it is. And currently I have 300 exactly packs. I'm gonna open this. I don't care about this. I already feel the Zendikar rising. So I basically would need, if I would now kind of, if I have, I mean, if I would open these, I wouldn't finish up my mythic rare collection of Kalades Remastered. But every mythic rare I pick during drafts means that I need to open 7 packs less, like an average. That's not exactly accurate because sometimes the packs can also have the wild card in the rare slot, so it's actually a slightly more than 1 in 7 packs where you get a mythic rare card. But regardless of that, it's pretty close to 1 per 7. So each mythic rare I pick in a draft does mean that I get closer and closer to the. So basically, this amount of packs needs to be, I mean, the amount of missing mythic rares I have has to be like 7 times the packs I mean, that amount times 7 needs to be, I have to have at least that many packs. Okay, was that clear? I will have a separate video, so that was maybe not so clear. But anyway, the point is that each mythic rare I pick means that I get that much closer to set completion. Of course, I'm not really, I don't need to complete this set. It's just a fun kind of side effect when you draft so much, you get to collect these sets. I'm not gonna, I play some historic every now and then, but I don't need a full collection. But it's just fun to do it. And yeah, he has the wild card stash, so I could craft everything I want anyway. But it's just a fun sort of side quest to fill the sets. Okay, that's it for now. So I will see you in the next draft. Bye bye.